We have several large cities such as Mumbai, Delhi, Chennai, Kolkata. Neglect of such concentrations can result in urban chaos, leading to deceleration in the economic growth and law and order problems. We therefore need to lay emphasis on urban governance, planning and financing. It would also be necessary to explore the possibility of developing secondary cities and towns by encouraging private investments, with the government playing a support role to provide infrastructural facilities to divert part of the migration from the larger concentrations. Government has taken several measures to address the challenges in urban sector. Jawaharlal Nehru National Urban Renewal Mission, launched by Government of India in 2005 to undertake urban infrastructure development and provision of the basic services to urban poor, is one amongst them. This has yielded some dividend, but more needs to be done. To achieve synergy in partnership schemes with the private sector using PPP models, government schemes alone cannot address the problems. Private sector, which would also benefit from the managed urban centers, have an important role to play in this direction. The less affluent economic groups face the brunt of the housing shortage. On the basis of the 2011 census, a technical group set up by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Poverty Alleviation has estimated that the total shortage in housing is 18.78 million in 2012, and of these, 95% is the economically weaker sections and low income group categories. This has led to approximately 25% of the urban population living in slums and squatter settlements. The government is seized of this reality and has launched the Rajiv Awas Yojana in 2009 to provide houses to slum dwellers with title certifications. Mortgage Guarantee Fund and interest subsidy schemes have been launched to safeguard the interest of the bankers and help beneficiaries. This is a major and significant step that has been taken by the government to resolve the housing problem of the urban poor. But as I have just emphasized, the private sector would have to take more initiative to find sustainable solutions. Government is taking steps to encourage private developers by making affordable housing construction attractive through direct and indirect incentives. Weighted deduction of 150% on capital expenditure under Section 35AD, external commercial borrowing, and service tax exemption on affordable housing projects are some of the incentives that I had the opportunity of announcement in my last budget speech as the finance minister. As you all know, there are major problems that bedevil the efforts of the low-income groups become homeowners. Significant among them is the difficulty in extending credit to this segment of the population through the banking channels. While high-income group and middle-income group segments have been able to reap the benefits of the low-rate mortgage loans and deductions available under the Income Tax Act, and home loan disbursement has gone up many-fold, the economically weaker sections and low-income group households have been left behind. Banks are generally reluctant to lend to them because of the perceived risk of the loans becoming non-performing assets. I am confident that banks would rise to the occasion to face this challenge and evolve innovative methods to allow greater credit flow to this segment. I hope that Mortgage Guarantee Fund and Interest Subsidy Scheme launched recently will make the credit flow to these segments easy. Another challenge, this sector is facing the shortage of land. Land is limited and accounts for up to 90% of the cost of houses in the metros. Both the government and the private sector should look at ways to augment land supply for housing. One way may be to look at acquisition of land in adjoining areas of the urban agglomerations and connect them to the city centers through rapid mass transportation system. Simultaneously, it should also be ensured that available landmass is utilized optimally by revisiting the planning norms. In addition, it should also be ensured that all the housing projects have schemes for low-income groups. This should be made a part of the town planning strategy. The importance of this requirement cannot be exaggerated, as the economically weaker sections provide the kinds of service without which urban agglomerations cannot have a healthy existence. These centers require services of taxi drivers, maids, cleaners, etc. Through this, inclusive growth can be encouraged not only as an existential requirement of agglomerations, but also as a social need. I am aware that there are many challenges associated with the land acquisition, township planning, project approval, constructions, and transfer of assets to beneficiaries. There is a need to look at the systems in place and provide solutions to make the dream of providing houses to the economically weaker sections of the society a reality. Special emphasis should be laid on adoption of innovative technologies, designs, and materials to speed up the delivery and reduced costs. Skill development is another important area that has particularly relevance to the housing industry, where new technologies have to be adopted and higher volumes achieved. Government and industry must join hands in finding solution to this challenge. National Skill Development Corporation is engaged in this task, and its effort must be further supplemented by the real estate industry to achieve the optimal results. Finally, I reiterate that housing and real estate sector holds the key to economic prosperity of the country because of its backward and forward linkages with other sectors of economy besides serving an important social objective. This sector is rightly termed as the engine of economic growth. I hope that this gathering of experts and important stakeholders will deliberate and find workable solution to meet the housing need of Aam Aadmi. There is a need of all stakeholders to join and work for achieving the objective of housing for all. Not only is it an economic imperative, but Article 25 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights casts a bounden duty on us to ensure, I quote from the text of the article, that everyone has the right to a standard of living adequate for the health and well-being of himself and of his household, including food, clothing, and shelter, unquote. And we should not be found wanting in our efforts to achieve this goal and fulfill our international commitment. I wish the convention all success. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for the patience. Jai Hind.